Making a virtual tour can be as easy or as complicated as you want it to be, depending on the overall workflow you take. Some workflows can take a long time, with hundreds of shooting and editing steps, while others can be super fast. In this video, I want to share some tips and tricks for keeping your workflow on the shorter side and minimizing time wasted while editing your virtual tour. Because time is money, and not every project requires a lot of your time in the editing stage, especially when good enough really is good enough. You can still make your tours look good without following the most advanced shooting and editing workflows. The first thing that applies to is your camera choice. While there are lots of fantastic 360 cameras out there, not all of them have fast workflows. And sometimes using a camera with a super fast workflow can be an advantage, especially if your use case isn't shooting for medium to high end clients. The tour I just shot, for example, I thought it'd be fun to document my house in its current state for me to look back at years in the future. And in order to do that, unfortunately, I don't have time to follow a long workflow, which is why I chose a camera that has an inbuilt HDR mode like the X4. There are a bunch of other fantastic choices for this as well. If you want my full list of camera recommendations, feel free to download my free gear guide below. So since I was using inbuilt HDR of the X4, I was able to shoot this entire tour in literally 5 minutes, and I didn't have to worry about manual exposure and so on. This leads me to the next step in the ultra simplified workflow, and that is editing. I'd say when it comes to virtual tours, editing is normally comprised of two separate stages. One is color correction, and two is assembling your virtual tour in a virtual tour software. If, however, you wanted to cut your virtual tour workflow in half, you could completely skip the color correction step, since you can do basic color correction in most virtual tour platforms. So it's up to you whether you want to skip it or not. I still do personally use Adobe Lightroom and Affinity Photo for color correction. However, not every single tour needs color correction, which means now the next stage is assembling your virtual tour. This video is sponsored by Cooler, and while I'll be using Cooler in this video, you can still follow along with other virtual tour platforms as long as they have the same features that I'm sharing in this video, which many of them should. So here's an example of color correcting inside a virtual tour platform. So I've uploaded my photos to Cooler, as you can see down here. And on the right-hand side, they've got a few filters here, nothing too fancy, but if you turn filter intensity up to 100%, it will show you the extreme version of what the filter looks like. They've got a few different looks here. The best one is bloom, and at 100%, it's way too oversaturated. But if I drag that slider down to about 20, the colors are definitely looking more vibrant. Now here's where the time saving begins. Instead of color correcting these photos one by one, and applying the filter, adjusting the intensity, and so on, you can just click this button here. And what this does is it applies that setting to all photos within the tour. So now if I save that, it will confirm that it's applying this to all photos. And when I go to the next photo, there you'll see it's added that bloom filter at 20% intensity. There are some other decent ones here. I quite like HDR tone mapping, since with interior shots, getting good dynamic range is always a challenge. So if you turn this up, you can see it reduces the contrast and gives the shot a more natural look. I'm quite liking this at 33%. And again, by pressing this button, it will apply this filter with this intensity to all photos in the tour. I'll turn the sharpness up just a little bit. It's important not to over sharpen your shots. So again, keep this one to a minimum. I'm going to leave mine at around 25%. We can always come back and change this later if it looks too oversharpened. And again, I'm going to hit the button here to apply this to all photos. Now when I click save and confirm, I'll go to another random photo in the tour. And here you'll see it's applied the color correction settings that I chose. Next, with the zoom settings, I think this is an important one to mention, because a common mistake I see beginners make is zooming out way too far with their shots, making them look really fisheye and unnatural. So here in Cooler, I can set the limits of how far people can zoom in and out. So if you move this slider from left to right, you'll get an idea of how far zoomed in each side is. And I'd recommend a zoom limit of -30, which is zoomed in, but not too far zoomed in that you can start noticing low quality. And then on the other side, I'm gonna go to +30, and I'll move this across. So now when I zoom in and out, there's a limit as to how far I can go to avoid the viewing experience looking bad. Again, just like with the other settings, if you click this icon, it will apply it to all shots after you've clicked save up the top. The next thing you'll normally be dealing with a virtual tour is the tripod at the bottom. Unfortunately, this is unavoidable, so you've got to get rid of it or cover it up somehow. I'll show you one super easy way to do this, and that is creating a pitch limit. So if I drag this slider across, it creates a limit as to how far people can move down and up. So now when I interact with this photo, it's like there's a border or a boundary here, as well as one here at the bottom that more or less eliminates the tripod by stopping the viewer from looking directly down. And since most detail in your virtual tour is going to be on the horizontal axis anyway, this is one of the fastest ways to eliminate your tripod from the shot without having to go to another program like Affinity Photo or Touch Retouch to remove it shot by shot. Again, click this button and save to apply to all photos. Aside from pitch limit, there is one more way to cover up your tripod, and that is through patching the nadir, which you can do right here in Cooler and some other virtual tour softwares. All you need to do is head over to Image, then Built-in Assets. I'm going to select this feathered circle. Now I'll increase the size of it here on the right hand side. I'll move it across to cover the tripod, make it a bit bigger. There we go. And now under Set Tint, if I go to Custom Color, here I can select an eyedropper and place the eyedropper around the carpet. This will capture the exact color of the carpet. So now when I head back to Set Tint, here under Recently Used Colors, here's the carpet color, and I'll choose Select. And that's done a pretty decent job. You probably wouldn't notice that if you were moving around this virtual tour quickly. You can also just add a logo here if you prefer, which you can find under Your Assets, then choose and upload your image like I have here, and there it is. Now I can adjust the nadir patch very easily by adjusting the width here on the right. If you want to add your logo to every one of your photos, just click Master and then Save, and this will now add it to every single photo within your tour. So again, this workflow is all about saving time through batch editing. The next step I normally take is adding hotspots. So I'm going to add one here up the top right. And to help save us time later on, what you want to do is choose your hotspot design, position, color, and text with the very first hotspot you place, since every future hotspot you place after this is going to replicate this one. So I'm going to choose change image, and I like this round circle here. It's very Matterport like. I'm going to change the position from 2D to floor, which will place it on the floor. Now I'll just click and drag it to make it look like it's a disc hovering on the floor about there. I'm going to adjust the size, see which size looks best. You don't want to go too big or too small. Usually 100% is about right. You can add text here if you like. However, I'm going to keep mine nice and simple and just have this round disc. So now I'll click save. And now any future hotspot I add is going to look like this hotspot. Now, of course, you'll need to connect this hotspot to another photo. In Cooler, it's under action. Then go to another post, click the next viewpoint, and if we click save and close, you'll see that the two photos are now connected. My next tip to do with hotspots is not adding too many if you can help it. While you might have several places in a line of sight of the camera, it's important not to overwhelm your audience too much with too many choices, which will also in turn create much more work for you to add multiple hotspots to every photo. So instead, I'd recommend choosing the 2 to 3 viewpoints max that your camera can see. That is within a few meters of the current viewpoint. So from this angle, I'd add one about here because I know my next photo is there. I'd add one over in the kitchen since there's a hotspot here as well. And one more only, which is in here. So I'll add that and reposition it. So this is keeping my workflow super simple. Instead of adding another one here and outside and in the backyard, I'm only adding the ones that are in immediate line of sight. Think of it like if you had to jump from the current viewpoint to the next viewpoint, how far could you get? That's usually a good indication of how far away you should put hotspots. My next tip for keeping things simple is to do with stairs. A common mistake I see all the time in virtual tours is people shooting photos at multiple points throughout the stairway, and it would essentially create a big long trail for people to have to follow just to see a stairway. Whereas really the best parts of a location aren't usually found on the stairway, but rather on the levels above and below. In which case, what I'd recommend doing is adding a hotspot, which is essentially going to act like an elevator, where people click it and it instantly transports them to the top of the stairway. stairs. So I'm going to change the image here, and it's simply going to be an up arrow. I'm going to change that from floor to wall, and I'm going to place it here in this empty space. Just make sure it's visible, so I'll put it about there. And now instead of having to navigate through four photos to get upstairs, it's just one click of a button, and I'll now link up the top of the stairs, which is here, and save. So now when I press this, I'm instantly transported up to the top of the stairs. This will save both you and your audience a ton of time. And something I always recommend with virtual tours is using as few photos as you can get away with. Not every square meter or square foot of a property needs a photo. A better rule of thumb is capturing one photo per room and just making sure you've got a clear line of sight from one photo to the next through the doorway. Now at this point, it's up to you how much more time you want to spend on your tour. Those really are the basics that are good enough for a quick and easy virtual tour. However, if you do want to add a few other small details, you're welcome to, like this sun effect. So you can reposition this sun. I'm going to put it right here at this light. And now when the viewer moves the perspective around, it creates that cool lens flare effect. However, this is definitely a nice to have and not a must have. And before you publish your tour as well, you'll just want to make sure all your shots do look good. Since when you're mass color correcting photos, sometimes there's an odd photo that has slightly different exposure to the others and might need a slight adjustment. Maybe more color, less color, more HDR tone mapping or less, especially when going from outside to inside. My final tip for keeping things simple is to do with the navigation bar. Here you can see we've got quite a few photos. This is literally every single photo of the tour. However, I've got some areas that don't need shortcuts down here, like this wardrobe and the ensuite as well. These are both connected to the master bedroom. So to remove them, I'm going to click close, and back to edit tour. And you'll notice with all of your photos, up the top left is an icon. If you hover over it, it says hide in thumbnail bar. If you click that, this will hide it in the thumbnail bar. So I'm gonna go ahead and hide any unnecessary photos since they have other photos very close by and are easy enough to navigate to from those photos. I'll click save. And there you can see we've just simplified this navigation bar to include only the most important areas of the house. So that's it for my top virtual tour editing tips. Hopefully this will help take your workflow from this to this. Four situations and virtual tours where you want to keep editing to a minimum. If you do want to learn the more advanced workflows, however, I do have a full course teaching my entire workflow for shooting, editing, getting clients, and getting paid with your virtual tours. Starting a beginner, going all the way through to advanced paid virtual tour photographer techniques. Now, if you're shooting virtual tours with an Insta360 camera, they do have a slightly different workflow to the other cameras. So in this video here, I'll share everything you need to know about shooting and editing virtual tours using whichever Insta360 camera you own.